Hello and welcome to this week's summer edition of Twa Teams One Street. I'm Tom Duthie. Podcasting alongside me this week are Alan Temple.
Hello.
Graeme Finnan.
Hello, everyone.
And George Cran.
Hello.
So, that's it. Season's over. Nothing to talk about. Let's all go home or to a pub.
It's been a quiet week, hasn't it?
Yeah, no. Nothing doing. Nothing doing at United, Alan.
Yeah, half that sounds squad. Great to me.
Half the squad's gone and they're finally confirmed as championship favourites for next season.
Yeah, half the squad gone is probably an exaggeration, but it might be what they need, to be honest.
I'm talking about half the squad. Quarter of the squad knows it and half the squad's about to find out in the next few weeks.
That might be the case, yeah. I mean, there was that sense of inevitability we did on the last episode, effectively do their relegation post-mortem, yeah. Because it was all but confirmed in such dismal fashion with that result against Kilmarnock. The game against Motherwell was same old in terms of defensive failings, but they were quite good going forward. United did actually create a fair few chances, and it was not that it'll be much solace to anyone of a Arab persuasion, but I mean, it was an entertaining game, really, really enjoyable way to bring the curtain down on the season. And yeah, as you say, it just confirms everything we already knew. They were going down and the rebuild starts. In terms of, we knew obviously Jamie McGrath and Loic Aina would go back to their parent clubs, but Ryan Edwards, Peter Pollitt, Liam Smith and Ian Harkes all leaving. And obviously it's a dire way for their United careers to end, but and there's always recency bias and anger and things like that, but those are four players with well upwards of, I think, 500 combined appearances for the club. So hopefully in the fullness of time, you know, it'll be recognised that they were good players, good servants for United, and although it didn't end the way they wanted to, it's, you know, hopefully that angle will assuage slightly, because it was a really poor campaign, but you know, they're not all of a sudden terrible footballers or terrible people. No. Sometimes things can just spiral, and each of them have Dundee United careers that they really, you know, they can be proud of. But there needed to be that change. That will just be the start of the change. Dundee United's last, you know, published accounts, June 2022, before a lot of these players were signed, was already at £5.9 million. That is not manageable in the Championship. Doing a little bit of digging, you know, finances and things like that. Yesterday, I was looking at the last Championship campaign that wasn't affected by COVID for Dundee United, and the turnover for that campaign was £3.1 million. So the maths don't add up. Dundee United don't need to move, you know, they'll need to make moves, they'll need to get people out, they'll need to try and get transfer fees in, and they'll need to rebuild their squad. So although we're in that kind of fallow period where it doesn't maybe sound like a lot is happening, I can assure you lots and lots and lots is happening. That rebuild, will have started already. And it'll be fascinating to see what gets done, because there is so much juggling to be done. There are so many financial challenges to be tackled, and a really interesting, I'm loath to call it exciting, because it's not a position anyone would have wanted it to be, but it will certainly be a fascinating summer ahead.
Yeah, I mean, just looking at the list of departures of the players who were, you know, under contract to United permanently, any real surprise, very different reasons for them leaving on top of relegation, but would you say any great surprise?
No, would probably be the short answer. There are cases that could be made for if Peter had been inclined to take a pay-as-you-play deal, there might have been an argument for that on a modest salary. And likewise, Liam Smith is a top professional with a lot of versatility and not on a huge wage. But I suspect Liam might have fancied a change. He's been at United for a while. He's not a local lad, so I think he might have options. You know, perhaps closer to the central belt, whether that's east or west. So
they'd become a bit of a squad player, eh?
Yeah, so you know, he might have fancied a fresh. And personally, this is just my opinion. I think he's a really, really unfair scapegoat for a lot of Dundee United's poor performances over the last 2 years. I think he gets a lot of unfair stick. Didn't have a great season this season, along with a lot of other players. But I think for some reason, I think he can be unfairly pinpointed at certain times. And if he fancies a change, I absolutely would not blame him. And in terms of Ian Harkes and Ryan Edwards, I think they would be, you know, Ryan clearly didn't have a good season and it would probably have moved on anyway, but they are also on, you know, a couple of the higher salaries at the club. So that is just a no-brainer that, frankly, there could be even better players than them out of contract and would probably have been released if it had made financial sense. So that's going to be the... There's going to be a lot of footballing decisions made, but there's going to be a lot of financial decisions made as well. Because
looking at it from the outside, Alan, I mean, my perception, more like looking with punter's eyes, would be Edwards paid the price. Harkes, he was close to going last summer. There was uncertainty over it. And I just wonder if it was more his decision than United's decision. Although financially, he would be on good money as well.
I think it's probably safe to say that all four of those players would be reasonably content to look for pastures new. That would probably be fair to say. I think, you know, there's been a lot of people in that squad that have felt bruised and battered and like it's not been a great season. And, you know, a change is as good as a rest for a lot of players. And I think there'll be a few there that are maybe thinking... look for something a wee bit different next season, because and this will sound callous as well, but it's not intended to. A lot of this squad had no intention of playing in the Championship, and I know a lot of people will say that, well, they're the ones that have taken them to the Championship, so they shouldn't be snobby about then having to battle back. But
players always are.
Yeah,
it's never one player's fault.
Exactly, and players are all incredibly cognizant that they have maybe 14 years at their very best to make the most of their career and make the most money as possible for their families. That is not being callous or shallow. That is life. You know, everyone has a career focus like that. They just happen to have a 14-year window in which to do it, you could argue. So that there might be a lot of those players that are thinking, not because they don't fancy a scrap, not because they're cowards, not because they're bailing out on the ship, but because they were promised a club that could challenge in the top six of the Premiership, and that is not what they've been delivered, regardless of how much blame they must take personally within that. So I think it'll be fascinating to see who does put their hand up and say, you know, please, you know, maybe invite offers for me. I'd like to go somewhere else. Because I think not only is Jim Goodwin making out that, you know, there's perhaps some, you know, he's just being a reasonable manager, I think there's also an element of he is acutely aware that he needs some players to do that, because as I've outlined with those two figures that I mentioned earlier, the light, you know, what the wage bill is probably around about now compared to what the turnover will be in the Championship, the maths do not work. They'll something needs to be flipped and changed. Otherwise, Mark Ogren is filling a big old hole from his pocket again.
I mean, they're pushing the money part aside, because you used to see my expenses, and you know, adding up was never a strength of mine. Although I always
unrealistic, I always said to you.
It was always the errors were always on the high side, I have to say. But new manager, players out of contact, even if in terms of quality he's getting like for like, Jim Goodwin, he'll know that sometimes, as Alan says, a fresh start's good.
I think it is. I mean, I can remember Dundee being relegated way back in 2005, and Jim Duthie was the manager, and a lot of that squad remained at Dens Park for the following season, whether that be because they were still in contract or not. But it just didn't work, you know, because there'd been a team who had been losing games, and that's what United have got to get a team now, suddenly switch the mentality to a team that is going to be winning games in that Championship. And sometimes you carry that hangover into the Championship, and it's difficult to get going again. I think
I should have asked George that question, because he's our, as the Dundee correspondent, he's our relegation hangover expert.
Yeah, absolutely. But I think you think they've done the easy part has been done. The players that have been released, it's never easy releasing players and players leaving the club. But the more difficult discussions have still to take place. The guys who are in contract, who they really have to get off that wage bill if they are going to freshen up that squad and build a squad that is capable of bouncing back at the first attempt. And that is going to be really, really difficult, Tom. There's going to be some hard talks over the course of the summer, and it's something that the board and Jim Goodwin have got to get their head around, because I'm sure, well, one or two, you would think... You've already mentioned a lot of them won't be wanting to play in the Championship for a start. And some of them, you would think, will get clubs, I'm talking about the likes, will get clubs on a comparable salary, if not a better salary, than what they're on at the moment. Yeah. Guys like Aziz Behic, you would expect to pick up something. And maybe Dylan Levitt, you would expect possibly to get someone. But there are a few others may find that, well, they'll get other clubs, it may not be on the lucrative salary that they're on at this point in time. And how do you get somebody to move? How do you get them to move office to take it and effectively take a wage cut? There could be a bit of sort of bargaining going on where United may still have to pick up some of the wages of these players who they want out the door, which is always a hard thing to do. So, yeah, a lot of hard discussions to take place over the next few weeks.
The Machiavellian side of me, you've mentioned Behic and Levitt, and there'll be a couple of others that other clubs might be sniffing about anyway. Who does Jim Goodwin want to knock his door and say, I think I can find another club, can I go? Who's Jim Goodwin going to go, hooray?
Well, it's like, you know, in any business...
That was a question for all the panel.
Right. In any business, when you're trying to make cuts, and United, as Alan has pointed out, the last time they were in, 3.2 million or whatever it was. I mean, they just simply cannot afford to have that sort of loss, but they still have to put a team on the park that is capable of bouncing back, because the nightmare gets even bigger if you don't get out at the first attempt. That's the problem they face. So where do they go with that, with the players they've got? What you want is, anybody looking at it, you look at the salaries, Tom, and you look who's earning the most money. And you're hoping that they will be willing to move on, but you know it's going to be really tough. But I do think they will get there. Unfortunately, Jim Goodwin has now obviously taken a well-deserved break after what's happened over the course of the season. I'm sure he might still be working behind the scenes, but over the next couple of weeks, things might be a bit quiet. Certainly for us at the newspaper, there'll be things going on behind the scenes, I'm sure.
Punters never realise, mobile phones mean that managers might be sitting on a sun lounger, but they spend most of that time on their phone.
But Jim Goodwin will like things to happen very quickly after that, so that he can build a squad. United will be playing in the League Cup sections. I think it's, George, it's mid-July, isn't it?
Yeah, July 15th, I think.
So he's been looking to put a team on the park, by that point in time.
Pre-season will be two and a half weeks, 3 weeks.
So he'll want things to happen quickly, but unfortunately that may not be the case. And
George, Bears given a very eloquent answer there about the theory and the generality, if you like, and Alan's got to speak to these guys for features for online and for the papers. I want names. Who does Jim Goodwin want to knock at his door and say, I'll go?
I completely avoided that. I
think that was a bit, I'm not giving you any clues, George, but I think that was a bit of goalkeepers union from Bear.
Yeah, it's a bit of that.
To be frank, I mean, he dropped a goalie for the last two games.
They'll be looking for a new goalie. I think it's pretty obvious. I honestly think anyone who chaps in his door and asks to go might be welcomed.
You'll have to consider it.
Is there anybody that's done enough this season to warrant indispensable status? I'm not sure. Fletcher, you'd want to keep in a footballing sense, but financially, that's a different conversation completely, isn't it?
If literally anybody in that squad other than Craig Sibbald was to say, I want to go, I would be inclined to let them, because pretty much everyone else, either fits into one of two categories, which is being paid Premiership wages or didn't perform to high enough standard last season. There's nobody other than Craig Sibbald that doesn't fit into one of those two categories. He is the archetype of what a Dundee United getting out the Championship player should probably be. He's a hard-working, diligent professional on a wage that you know Dundee United can cope with. It's he, to be honest, he's the you know he should have been the archetype in terms of their recruitment last summer, but they've gone and tried to get all Hollywood and it's been a disaster. So it's you could pinpoint individuals as it's not that anyone doesn't want to do it. It's just unnecessarily cruel. But you could you could point out one of anyone, and whether it's for financial reasons or for performance reasons, they could not argue with being on that list. But it's Goodwin's made it clear he will welcome anyone that wants to leave because he wants a club that he wants players that are enthusiastic and passionate about the opportunity to win a Championship title with Dundee United, and there will be plenty of pros out there that fancy that challenge. It's I don't think it might not be the most attractive situation in the world if you were pitched European football in top six finishes. However, there's a whole other tier of player out there, very, very capable footballers, for whom getting the chance to play for Dundee United and challenge for a title, and then perhaps if you make yourself
a
key man
to the Premiership.
100%. There you go. You, all of a sudden, you could be a key man in a Dundee United side that's just been promoted to the Premiership. So there will be a lot of players out there that fancy that, but there just needs to be some rearranging of things before that can really happen.
Yeah, he'd keep the young lads. You'd think because they'd be. I'd think
you could sell them.
No, they'd be on relatively low wages, and they've. Quite a few of them have shown that they're capable.
Yeah.
I think I'm sure Ross Graeme would be okay in the Championship. I know he's not had the best of seasons, but he was good in previous seasons. I think Kai Fotheringham's looked okay, hasn't he, Alan? I think he'd be quite capable in the Championship.
My only fear is
guys like
my
that.
My only fear is that they see one or two of these kids as immediate saleable assets, which young players can be to clubs down in England. It's the Rory McLeod, that gives me the fear a wee bit. I think Rory would hugely benefit from a season of the Championship because in my view, playing 30 games the season in the Championship is probably where Rory should be. He shouldn't have been pitched into playing up front in a Premiership relegation battle. He should be at a formative stage in his career, so I think he would really benefit from a season in the Championship as like a starting player. But I do have my fears in terms of it. I think he would still be seen as a saleable asset. But I absolutely agree with George. If I was building this Dundee United squad from the ground up, I would be looking at guys like Rory McLeod, Matthew Cujo, Kai Fotheringham. Even down into, you've got Chris Mockrey, Archie Meekerson, Ross Graeme, Flynn Duffy. There is a core there of boys that you wouldn't start every week, but they can be your depth. They can be impact
energy
footballers. Yeah, and then you add your senior pros to that and you start to build a squad. That's what a Dundee United squad should look like. You know, that's what sustainable football clubs are supposed to be, you know, your core of senior pros, and then rely on your youngsters. But they somewhat got away from that last season, to say the least. And there's a lot of those boys that have done really well out on loan. You know, you've seen the way that, you know, Kai Fotheringham's come back from Stirling Albion and done absolutely fine. There's no reason why Chris Mockrey can't come back for winning a league title with Dunfermline and do fine. And as I say, there are. I think Archie Meekerson's a fabulous young footballer. I think he's, providing he comes back from his injury, he should play more next season. And I'm absolutely not trying to convince Dundee United fans that are rightfully angry and disenchanted that everything will be fine and this will be a good thing.
When we talk about all these young players, you do think, how did it come to this? There's so much talent there.
Yeah, well, that's the positive aspect if you are going to dig in for a positive one, and it's not to be patronising, but maybe this can be a rebuild. Maybe this can be a chance for Dundee United fans to go to Tannadice on a Saturday and see some young, talented boys that they actually identify with, that are hard-running, supplemented with senior pros that are knocking their pan in for 3 points. And after the way that the last season went and the amount of sort of meek surrenders and performances that was just lacking in gumption, maybe that'll be something that, in a perverse way, even if it is championship football, fans can enjoy and get on board with, you know.
In some ways, man, is it a test of the owner's deep, how deep his pockets are, and also that side of the club's nerve? And that you could take the gamble, really back your manager, get 5 or 6 seasoned pros. Maybe in a year's time, you're promoted, and then you get better money if you keep the young players now, because they've got talent, they've got energy, they've got hunger. And if you get the balance right, and they have a really good season in the championship, and they're always going to have to sell. There's not that, but it's a big call to say we're definitely going to get promoted, and in a year's time, 3 of them might move down south for 6 figures more than they're moving this summer if clubs come in for them.
Yeah, I mean, the owner has already shown he's got deep pockets.
Yeah.
Done. I mean, Mark Ogren has pumped in millions to the club. I still think the biggest job that they've got is, you're talking about all these good youngsters, and there's some terrific young players there, supplementing them with 5 or 6 senior pros. But how do you need to go and get these senior pros? How do they do that? Is the owner going to sanction signings when they've still got, trying to get guys off the books that they don't know where they're going to go? I'm sure Jim Goodwin may want to keep some of the senior pros who are already there, but
it just strikes me, for a start, I mean, there's going to be competition, and there's a team across the road,
absolutely,
in a league above, and they're not worried about having to keep players because almost everyone was out of contract.
Yeah, and it's also the case that players don't wait. I mean, unless the players that United are going to be looking at will be getting offers elsewhere. If United are basically saying, look, we'd like to sign you, but
you're going to have to wait.
You're going to have to wait for a few weeks. Players just don't wait. And there's other clubs in the Championship as well, Tom. I'm talking about the likes of Dunfermline and that, who know they've done really well in League One, and James McPake has done a terrific job there. He knows that to get them where he wants it, maybe
he's looking for 1 or 2 rather than 5 or 6.
Yeah, so it's the big, how do we get these players out the club to bring new players in? But that's what United need to be. United need to be a lean, mean fighting machine if they're going to get out that Championship. That's the model. A few senior pros, you know, but all these sort of top young players they've got. But it is, we see the Championship at these neck of the woods all too often, and it does become a grind, and you need to have players with the right mentality to get yourself through that, you know, and be prepared to go for the entire distance. Very few teams. United did it the last time, I've got to say, under Robbie. Hearts have done it under Robbie as well, where they've basically run away with it. I don't see that happening next season, so you've got to have the squad there with the stiffness to do it.
Is the biggest positive of the past week at Tannadice the news that Jim Goodwin's there for the next 2 years at least?
It's certainly.
You tend to think
we did speak about this last
week.
He's got that
bit of experience now. He's had his bad time at Aberdeen, he had a good time at St Mirren and Alloa, but also, will he have more influence than recent United managers? Because, and I'm not having a go at the guy, but Tony Ashgar isn't there. Tony Ashgar's job was to get involved in that side. Now, you just get the vibe that Jim Goodwin has more of a say in who's coming in, what type of player's going to be signed. And I see that as a positive, because I do like him as a manager.
Yeah, well, I think you've
thanks for backing me up there, guys.
I thought I was just going to Alan. Just waiting for Alan, but he's on a delay, so...
I was just waiting to find out who you were asking the question to, Tom. I'm the one in the room with you, remember?
No, it was another rambling rant.
Right, okay, very good. You're right, and I think stability is key. I'm not going to pretend that if you were to call this last couple of months Jim Goodwin's audition for the job on a longer-term basis, let's not pretend he passed it with flying colours. The post-split fixtures were a disaster. So that's however, they're a disaster. You know, you served up a kind of disastrous meal, but with ingredients that somebody else picked for them, and they were all rotten, kind of, if you were to use that as a metaphor. So it's not his fault as such, but, you know, he didn't do a great job in the aftermath of that split. But what he did do is he brought leadership, he brought a comprehension of what's gone wrong. He's very, very forthright in dealing with people, and I think that will be incredibly useful because, as you say, it's a club that currently doesn't have a sporting director, they don't have a financial director, and they need a manager who can, they also, you know, have a recruitment department that's responsible for the recruitment that just got them relegated there. So they, what they do need is a manager that comes in with his own ideas, his own experience of building a squad without too much oversight, which he did at Alloa, and I think he is as good an appointment as is out there for Dundee United. So, but most of all, I just think that stability is key, because whether they would publicly say so or not, footballers are massively affected by uncertainty. This is their livelihoods, and the fact that these players have played under three different managers in one season, they will tell you privately that that has been incredibly difficult. It's different managers with different ideas on how to set up, different ideas on how to work with them, different ideas of which players they really like, for example. And that all plays on footballers' minds. It has not been a good situation. And stability going into next season, particularly when we... God, how many things have we spoken about that need fixed? Imagine you were also looking for a manager right now. it doesn't bear thinking about. So it's the right decision, but let's not kid ourselves that the pressure won't be on. Obviously, Jim, starting next season, they'll need to hit the ground running. They'll be expected to be at the top end of the table, and if not, then punters will inevitably start going, well, we saw this coming. We lost all five post-split games and conceded 12 goals. So
now, the reality is it not that basically he signed a 2-year contract, but you'll only have a two years minimum at Tannadice if he gets promoted, because you would think he wouldn't survive an unsuccessful campaign next year. Although, yeah, of course, I'm quite confident for United.
Yeah, I admire your confidence, considering I've got absolutely
maybe
no idea
what faith.
Yeah, I've got no idea what the team will look like or what the team will be shaped up as, or who will still be there, who will be gone. So for you,
I have no
you
idea
to,
why, I, to, why I feel so confident.
Yeah. So for you to be pitching a runaway title win on June the 1st, I admire that optimism.
No pressure, Jim.
Yeah. I think it'll be much, much harder than that, I have to say. I know people look at the championship this past season and look at the points totals and stuff and say it's been a poor season, but I think it's been harder than it looks. There's quite a few good teams in there. Queen's Park are going to be stronger, whoever their manager is going to be. As you say, Dunfermline are coming up. You might have Ross County coming down.
Yeah, that gives...
If not, Partick looks strong.
That gives me the fear a wee bit, the concept of Ross County coming down, George. Yeah. It's because we know from history and that Roy will put his hand in his pocket to get out of that division. And if they do go down, I don't think Roy McGregor's going to let his club wallow in the championship for long. I think they will put a real concerted push. And they have been sensible enough to have a squad that, should they go down, a lot of players will go down with it. They'll either leave the club or they are the type of boys that are conditioned to get them back up from the championship. Mm-hmm. So I would worry about them, and I would also slightly worry about Raith Rovers, because Josh Mullen and Jack Hamilton are fabulous championship signings. That is two of the most... That is one of the most reliable deliverers of a football and one of the most reliable converters of chances at that level. That are out there. So I think they're doing some really interesting things. I know the guys that have taken over there a wee bit, and they're good, competent people. So I would be expecting Raith Rovers to be right up challenging for the playoff positions as well. So I suspect it will be another battle, and I actually think the levels of that division might rise a little bit when you look at Dunfermline coming up to replace Hamilton, for example. I think the levels are going to rise.
You've got Morton as well. Obviously, Doug Imrie improved towards the end of the season. They'll mount a challenge.
And if Ross County win the playoff, you've got a Partick Thistle side that are also rejuvenated under Chris Doolan and look pretty good. I mean, it's going to be an absolute.
I'm glad Dundee aren't in that division, George.
I have to say, Dunfermline, Morton, Partick Thistle, whether they're in the mix for promotion, whoever the top two are at the end of next season will not take maximum points at those grounds.
No.
And that's what I always... That was my fear about Dundee not getting up, was if Dunfermline and Falkirk were promoted, it's two places where you wouldn't expect to take maximum points over a season when you're visiting, because they're always tough places to go, whatever their situation
is. But Gary Boyer always said, right from the start, he said, this is going to go right to the wire. And I kept saying, we don't want that. We want to be, by the end of the season, you know, when you're coming in the final straight, 5 or 6 points ahead and make it easy for yourself. But he was absolutely spot on. Mm. I'm not sure if he knew it was going to go right to the wire, you know, the second 45 minutes of the last game, effectively. But that's you can see it being the same next season, Tom, just as competitive. Yeah.
I have to say, I stand by it. I think it is a league you can run away with. But I think if we were to look at it sort of forensically, every time a team has won that league by a big margin, they've basically won the league by October.
Yeah.
If you've not got that gap by after the first couple of months or 3 months, it's going to be a dogfight for the rest of it. I think you have to start well, get a gap, because then, especially if you're one of the bigger names, like, again, one thing in United's favour, if they're 5 points ahead in October, other teams are worried. Because they're like, how do we... And we saw even what got Dundee through in the end was... They had the biggest squad, and that absolutely. Other teams were getting hurt at various times, but Dundee could bring people in, and hopefully that'll be a strength for the United next season.
And that's what they'll hope the benefit is of keeping Jim Goodwin as the man in the hot seat, because obviously he's been at United for the past few months and knows exactly where the issues are, what needs to be fixed. It's Dundee last year had a new manager in place who'd never never competed in Scottish football at all, so he was learning on the job, learning who his players were, who he preferred, and systems, and countless subs, if you ask Dundee fans.
Yes.
And that hurt Dundee early on. We're talking about United having to be prepared for this very quickly. So
Jim Goodwin will know that.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's
why it's a great appointment, isn't it?
Yeah, because you'd hope that... Well, he'll know exactly on the first day of the season who his best team is, and how they're going to work, and how they're going to attack the championship.